everybody, and welcome. We realize it's the afternoon of the last day of the conference, so thank you all for making the time to come out here and join us for this panel discussion. We are going to be talking about Who Defends Your Data, a program that we've been working on with, first of all, I should introduce myself. My name is Kurt Opsahl. I am the Deputy Executive Director of the Electronic Frontier Foundation. And we've been working on a project for a number of years now to use ranking systems to improve transparency and accountability with service providers by providing gold stars for people who, for companies that adopt best practices. Let me give just a very brief introduction of what that is, and then we can go down the line. Everyone can introduce yourselves. This started with a program we called Who Has Your Back in the United States, where we looked at a number of internet service providers, telecommunications providers, and gave them gold stars if they had adopted good practices in defending their users when the government came to seek the user data. So we were looking for things like transparency reports, notice to the user when a request came in, defending the users in court and in the legislature, publishing guides that explained how they would give up data and for what legal process, and trying to improve the standards for process that they would need to require a warrant before giving up the content of communications. This started in 2011, and at that time, a couple of the companies got a few of the stars, not too many, but it started to work in the sense that after we published our first report, companies improved their practices. They wanted to get rated again to show that they have improved. We turned it into an annual report. And we've been doing this at EFF every year since. So the 2017 Who Has Your Back report is coming out hopefully by the end of the month. We're actually still working on that right now. But it has been tremendously effective in encouraging good practices. We've also been raising the bar, changing the methodology to when something has been widely adapted as an industry practice, it no longer as much of a best practice, so we try and raise the bar to have ever-improving standards. Last year, we did a version that was focused on some of the gig economy companies like Uber and Airbnb. And then for the last several years, we've been working with organizations throughout Latin America who have been adopting a similar system, but providing their own methodology customized to that country, and for the most part have been focused on telecommunications providers with the idea that by providing these rankings, when there is competition in the marketplace, the consumers can be educated about who has better practices, make decisions about what companies they want to work with based upon that, get some media coverage, focusing on their practices, and then by doing it year after year, can help rise the tide and put some both transparency in what those practices are and encouragement for improvements. So with that, let's go and have all introduce yourself.
Hello, can you hear me? Yes. I'm Luis Fernando Garcia. I'm the director of the Digital Rights Defense Network, R3D, from Mexico. And we've been working on Who Defends Your Data for 2 years, and we'll talk about it later.
Carolina Botero from Fundación Carisma in Colombia. We've also did our first release of the report in 2015, and last year this one.
Hi, everyone. My name is Dennis Antoniali. I'm the executive director of Internet Lab, which is a think tank on internet law and policy based in São Paulo, Brazil. And last year was our first edition of the Who Has Your Back in Brazil.
Hello, everyone. I'm Juan Carlos Lara. I work at Derechos Digitales, which is based in Santiago. And we did the study for Who Has Your Back, like national version of Chile, the last year, but it has not been released yet. So I'll look forward to tell you a bit about that, too.
All right. Well, thank you, everybody. I guess let me go into a little bit more detail on some of the concepts behind methodology, and then perhaps we each can talk about the methodology used in our own countries. Part of at least for the Who Has Your Back program that I worked at, worked on it with EFF, we tried to pick categories to rank the companies on that would show good practices, that would have at least some companies who would be doing better than others to encourage that competitive element. So it's something that would be a stretch but within reach. And I'll sort of give an example to flesh that out a bit. In requiring a warrant for disclosure of the content of communications, when we started the program, there was a court case that determined that under the Constitution, the government was required to get a warrant, but that court case was not a nationwide precedent. It was not binding on the government in every jurisdiction, and so the government asserted that it was only binding in that one jurisdiction and everybody else was not protected. And so what we wanted to do was to reward those companies that adopted a policy whereby they wouldn't give up the information without a warrant, and then that would force the government either to get a warrant or go to court to explain why they didn't think that a warrant was necessary. And it was pretty effective. First started out with a couple of the larger internet companies, Facebook and Google and Twitter were some of the earlier adopters on there, but there's a large percentage of users. And over time, this became an industry standard, which meant that this court case, while not a binding precedent, was de facto the rule for most of the users. And so this is part of that concept of using it for competition. So when one company did it, it increased the chances for other companies to adopt a similar practice. And also when there was a split in the law, when there was a question, is to give an incentive for the company to adopt the better practice. And what we've also learned when talking with some of the people at the companies, that this was actually very useful in their internal discussions to have something that they could point to. When they're having an internal discussion about, well, should we do this? Should we go out there? Well, maybe the government will be upset with us if we put this barrier out there, to have something to counteract that. To say, well, if we do this, then we will get higher ranked, we will get some positive media coverage. So it provides a counterbalance to the government saying, we want to get this information with the least effort possible. So that's sort of some of the concepts of the methodology that we were using. You guys want to talk about some of your methodology and thinking on that?
Sure. In the case of Mexico, we, as I mentioned before, we have done two times the Quien Define Tus Datos report, Who Defends Your Data. And we changed a bit the methodology between the second version and the first version. This it's not ideal because then you cannot completely compare the both measurements, but we believed it was necessary due to the changes in the law in Mexico and other developments that required us to change it. And we measured six parameters. One is privacy policy. In general, we try to establish standards that are can be measured objectively, that are not do not depend on subjective analysis. However, we do. It's not. Although most of the parameters that we measure are policy based or on based on what we can find or what the company discloses and makes public, there are a certain elements inside each parameter that in which we measure also the practice. So it's not sometimes it's not enough for a company to say that they, for example, require a warrant. If we have evidence that even though your public policy is that you require a warrant, but you don't, and we have evidence of that, you also get, the company also gets less points, to say so. So we measure privacy policy, we measure the judicial warrant, whether they required it, both for content and for metadata. In Mexico, also there's a judicial precedent that you need a judicial, federal judicial warrant to get access to both content and metadata. We measure also if they have policy on notifying the user. We measure transparency, whether they have transparency reports, but not only if they have transparency reports, we do some measurements on the quality of their transparency reports, because very often some companies just give a number that it's really not useful for anything. Or, for example, publish transparency reports in a language which is different from Spanish in the case of Mexico, so it's really not that useful for all users in the country. And the fifth element is the commitment with human rights. In this, we measure whether they have a human rights policy, whether they engage in multi-stakeholder or in other human rights groups like GNI or like the Telecommunications Industry Dialogue. And the sixth one, we measured eight telecommunication companies in Mexico. Three of them are mobile, and we measure, this is an additional parameter for the mobile telecommunication companies, in which we, using the data protection law of Mexico, we requested access to our communications metadata, the kind of metadata that an authority will get if they would request it. And the three companies did not granted access to that metadata, and we measured that and evaluated that. That was for the report, but we challenged that denial by the company with the DPA in Mexico, the Data Protection Authority, and we won those cases. But still, we evaluated whether the commitment to the right to data protection is just a commitment, or they actually, when you ask for your data, do they give it to you? So those are basically the six parameters that we use, and I would stop here to let others speak as well.
So in Colombia, we're doing ¿Dónde están mis datos? Since 2015 as well, and we have five criteria that are into three different points. So the first one is data protection. We decided to use the data protection because even if Colombia has data protection laws, the truth is that they are only formally, what we found is they are only formally applied, let's say. So the law says that you have to have data protection policy, and all the companies have a data protection policy, but they go from a copy paste of the law that is in a GPG format, so it's an image, to fairly well described policies. So we at least wanted to see even if it was possible to have a data protection policy. And as I said, they are, or you can't find them. They are like in very hidden in the web page. So everybody has a data protection policy, but the truth is none of the companies have a policy that is good. There are other criteria that look at privacy issues, and there are others that look at freedom of expression. One of the topics that Carisma worked for a while, for a, for some time is the issue of content removal. So we looked at policy on content removal. In the privacy topic, we looked at issues of surveillance, just similar to what Luis Fernando described. What we want to look at is how and if they respond to the request by the government. I would only say that the methodology has worked to make the corporations more responsive, and they have improved a little, but there's a lot more to do there.
So, as I said, like last year was the first year, and we're doing the second edition this year. So we are reassessing the companies again, and so we try to keep the same criteria for the assessment to make the comparison easier. So we have like similar criteria. The first one is about whether the companies provide clear information about the data that they collect and what do they do with the data. And that's something that is required by law. Like in Marco Civil, you have a provision requiring companies to give users clear information about those practices. But that's something that we could not really find. And we looked not only to the privacy policies, but also to the contracts that they provide to the users and documents like that. And there was very little information about how much data they collect and what they do with that. The second criteria is more specifically about the public commitments that they make with regard to compliance with data requests from the government. Under Brazilian law, different types of data get different sorts of protections. So there are some cases in which law enforcement can get access to account information without a warrant. And for other sorts of data, then you need a warrant, and it's assessing whether they have made that public commitment to that and explain that to users. The third criteria is whether the company's been fighting for privacy in the courts. So whether they've been challenging legislation that was not good for users' privacy, or whether they're challenging in court abusive requests. The fourth is about fighting for users' privacy in public debates. So Brazil has been organizing, like the government's organized a few times public consultations on pieces of legislation. And in the first year that we did this, it was a very heated debate about our draft of the data protection law. So we kind of analyzed whether these companies like participated in that debate on their own name and not through associations, because that kind of it's not that transparent about like where the arguments and the interests are coming from. And the last criteria is the notification criteria. So whether companies provide as soon as they can, when it's not unlawful to do so, whether they notify the user that data about them has been requested.
Okay, so in the case of Chile, because this cannot be verified by us, it's not been published yet, the things that we discussed and the things that we analyzed are pretty much the same in very broad terms to what my colleagues have mentioned in the other countries. When we went to see how the methodology would adapt with the help of the Electronic Frontier Foundation to start this process, we took a view about the old reports that were out by the Electronic Frontier Foundation back in the day, half a decade ago, because we understood that in any case we should try to set high standards. However, that process of reviewing what are the things that we can measure in each country, and I can probably assume with some level of safety that for my colleagues has been a similar process, that sometimes those standards might be way too high for some of our companies, and in many cases, when they have some level of transparency about their practices, and let alone about their actual practices, it's not necessarily because of their preoccupation with informing the users, but in many cases it has to do with complying with legal obligations. The things that we analyzed in the Chilean case were first about the terms and conditions in terms both about the public policies that they hold and the transparency about them, but also about the contractual conditions that a potential user, a potential client of an ISP would be adhering to if they hired their services. In a second group of analysis, the transparency reports and whether they exist and what's the level of information that they have if they exist. Third, whether there's some level of notifications to users, whether they are given notice that their data is being requested or has been given up, or that they have been subject to an investigation that made them subject also to an obligation to give up their data. There's also, as a fourth point, whether they have an internal legal policy to deal with this kind of requests in each of the companies. And in the fifth group is about how have the companies taken to the defense of the interests of their consumers, either in court or even before authorities or even before the legislations. And the legislative process, whether they have been in Congress to say something about the privacy or about the personal data of their users. The last point is particularly relevant because most of our exchanges with companies in the Chilean context have been in the halls of Congress. Only in a few recent years, both ISPs and internet companies have been closer to us to meet and to discuss outside of Congress, which is a good thing, but at the same time, it proves to us that many of the practices and the influence that they have is often hidden from view, even when in some cases it coincides to defend the interests of the users with the interests of the companies, for instance, to reject some data retention mandates. But through the adjustment of these factors, we took a view to those five groups of information, and from that are the results that will be published in maybe 3 weeks from now.
So one of the things that I think has been one of the most successful in this project overall is encouraging transparency reports. When we started the original program in 2011, transparency reports were a fairly rare thing. I was just about to look up how many there were back then, but the internet is a little bit slow here. But nevertheless, I can tell you that sort of this was something that took a little while to get rolling, but by the time we had gotten to our fourth annual, the vast majority of companies were issuing regular transparency reports, and then for the fifth one, and it was all but one had transparency reports, I think we're hopeful, at least for our, that we'll have almost universal transparency reports for this year. And I think that now spreading that has been a bit of a challenge. The notion of regular transparency reports has not become fully internationalized, but I think that's where we've started to see at least a little bit of progress there, would you say?
Yeah, definitely. For example, in our case, in the first Kindefinitus Datos report in 2015, none of the companies had a transparency report. It must be said as well that in 2016 report, AT&T was now one of the companies that was evaluated, and it definitely, since it had been more used to these discussions in the US, it came with better standards than what the local or other international telecommunication companies, such as Telefonica, for example, had. So in this year report, last year report, AT&T had a transparency report, but not the others, although now Telefonica already has published a transparency report or something that could be qualified very broadly as a transparency report. However, we also, as I mentioned, we also measured not only that you have a transparency report, but whether this transparency report, for example, is in Spanish, or if it provides enough granularity, enough points of data about the request, for example, to government request to get access to user data. What we would want to see is the transparency reports that inform us not just a global number of how many times authorities in general have requested, but we would like to know which authorities, how many times they've been, this information has been denied by the company. And this is something that is missing from transparency reports. However, in Mexico, very recent reforms have introduced obligations to report to the telecommunications authority. So now, even though that's not a transparency report, because it's those documents are public but are not published, we have had to request them through access information requests, and then we have found interesting things, like for example, the biggest mobile telecommunication company in Mexico called Telcel, which is part of America Mobile, one of the biggest telecommunication companies in the world. In the first semester of 2016, received 26,000 requests by authorities to get access to user data, but they denied 0%. Like every time an authority came to Telcel and asked for data, they gave data. In contrast, AT&T, for example, denied around 46% of the requests, which indicates that AT&T does have a process in which it vets which requests they will comply and which they won't, and Telcel doesn't. So it's important not just to stress to companies that just publishing a paper that says transparency report and a global number of requests, it's a good step forward. We give you a little bit of credit about it, but we need more.
When we did the first report in 2015, we were very ambitious. And we don't just have that there should be a transparency report, but we also have a lot of things that we would like to see in a transparency report. The problem is in Colombia, I think in Latin America, the only country that has the mandatory obligation is Mexico. So there's no obligation for a transparency report, therefore zero transparency report. And by 2016, the same was happening, and we thought, like, nobody's doing a transparency report, and there's also a problem on top of that. In Colombia, when you talk about transparency report, corporations think on corruption. So it's a tool for fight corruption, and it's been really a two-year work to make them understand that we're not talking about their financial numbers, but more this issue of human rights. So there was not going to happen. Nobody had a transparency report. Therefore, currently our criteria is whether there is a transparency report. And we have a list of recommendations on what we would like to see in a transparency report. But I agree with Luis Fernando that there's not enough a transparency report, because what we will see this year, there's already an AT&T report, and there are two numbers about Colombia. But the two numbers doesn't say anything, and therefore, again, good, there's a transparency report. There's a transparency report that says something about Colombia, but it's in English. It doesn't tell much. It's not gonna be what would be useful for users in Colombia. So big thumb up, that's great, but wouldn't be enough.
Yeah, so in Brazil, I think we have this similar tradition that companies are just not used to having transparency reports. So our criteria was first whether they have one. But what we didn't consider that we found in some companies was like what they call a sustainability report, which they somehow advocated that it was very similar to a transparency report, but it didn't have any information on the privacy policies that we wanted. So that's something that we started to engage the companies to understand what kind of information we expect to have in a transparency report. Something that we also got was that they are not obliged by Brazilian law to publish transparency reports. So why were we asking them to do so, especially because, and that came from, I think, several meetings that we had, is that it's always very sensitive, the narrative that they're going to adopt in the transparency report, because it can be seen as something that they're antagonizing with law enforcement, and there are a lot of tensions between ISPs and law enforcement. This is like, these are companies that are present in all the cities of the country, and sometimes you have a lot of power by the authorities, and they are in a difficult position because they're not trying to antagonize it that much. So I think these are like additional challenges that we face when we're trying to push for transparency reports in Brazil.
Yeah, the point with Chile is very much similar to the case of Brazil that Dennis mentioned, in the fact that because there is no obligation to publish transparency reports, and even less so to publish transparency reports that involve the information that we want to have, there are some companies that publish these sustainability reports that are a PR effort that does not have much information that can be used in any way. It's a very much to say, even in the case of the interests of users, that they care about them. Sometimes that declaration exists in these reports. So we took that and the existence of those reports as a starting point for the conversation to move forward to the kind of information that is needed from the companies. So in that sense, it's true, the sustainability reports do not constitute transparency reports. But there is a form of reporting that can be used for the demands that we have, especially in those two cases in Chile where they mentioned that they do care about the privacy of their users. So we took that as a point of analysis. We saw those declarations, and the task now with that kind of information is to make it become a transparency report. Again, not required by law. Again, something that might be taken as demanding from companies, something that they are not obliged to provide, but at the same time, something that helps their users even to make the decision between companies, and that helps people with the preoccupations, like ourselves in civil society, that this kind of information may exist, so the rights of the users of the services of these companies can be properly defended.
Very good. And I think, you know, the transparency reports, I think, is an interesting example, because it's an end and a means to an end. So it is an end in the sense of having something that users can look at and understand what the company is doing with data, and what the risks they face when using it, maybe comparing one to another. But that's sort of also why it's a means to an end, which is to improve the practices by allowing information on what they are that helps enable the consumer choice. It helps people be able to judge, like one company was pushing back and had refused a number of the requests. Another company was granting all of them. So it's useful to have one whatsoever, so that's like the baseline. But then once the baseline is satisfied, to improve what they are, both through encouraging a fuller report, and by having this sort of as part of the competitive landscape, so that when users are making a decision about what kinds of, which services to contract with for their telecommunications needs, they can do that with this information in mind. So trying to have these sort of things build on each other. But it takes time to build this, so it's starting. I was able to pull up our first report in 2011, and there were no companies got a full star for transparency. Two companies out of the, at that point, about 10 or 11, who got half stars. So that was it took a slow start, so it's not very surprising that this is starting to roll, but it's going to take a while to go forward.
Well, on that, I would say that because of the very small information that we have, in some cases, yes, we are considering half stars, but if we're very rigorous, they would be much less than that.
Yeah. Awesome. Well, another thing that has come up in a number of contexts, which is sometimes a challenge, is notification to the user. So, as a policy matter, this is a very important thing for users to receive notice when there has been a government request for their data. The user is in the best position to challenge that request. If it is improper, to try to stop it from going through, and at the very least know what is happening to them. But then there comes that tension with law enforcement, who doesn't want someone to challenge the request, and in some cases they are nervous that if this is they're trying to hunt down a bad guy, and then if they get notice that the authorities are on their trail, they may run or destroy evidence or such. And this has sort of come back in the form of a lot of back and forth and communications, where one of the useful things about putting together these rating systems is encouraging, giving companies a reason to adopt the better practices, and as more companies do it, make it something that if law enforcement is upset, it is a little bit more diffuse as more companies are adopting these practices and the law enforcement gets used to it. The goal is to have it so if there is a reason to not provide notice to the users, and in many countries there are laws by which they can the government can issue a gag order that would prevent that notice, but requiring the setting up the system so the government is required to actually go through that effort, prove to a court that it is necessary, and have the default be to provide notice.
Yeah, in the case of Mexico, this is an area in which no company has a policy on notifying the users, and it's been difficult in the discussions that we had with representatives from companies. It's difficult to progress in this point since the law doesn't prohibit it. It doesn't prohibit notifying users, but there's, at least I would say, there's uncertainty. And there was uncertainty on many aspects of the law that regulates when and how authorities can request data from users. But that's precisely why it's important to have a user notification, because, for example, in the case of Mexico, companies like Telcel won't defend you. And that's why you can't rely on the company defending you. Also, because, for example, thanks to triangulating the information that we got not only from companies but also from authorities and from judicial from the judicial power in Mexico, 99% of the times that an authority went for user metadata, they did it without a warrant. This was because the law wasn't clear, and companies didn't know that they were not sure whether they needed to require for a warrant, and the authorities were not sure at all. And then we do a litigation against the law, so now it's clear. But when it wasn't clear, we managed to prove that there was authorities that don't have powers to use surveillance and to get access to this kind of data that did access, and that 99% of the times they did it without a warrant. And that's why it's very important to also have the user notification. And I think there's plenty of things that have been written about how you can balance not jeopardizing investigations and the evidence of crime, and also guaranteeing that there's notification, at least a delayed notification, once the circumstances that require the secrecy of the request are no longer there. What I think it's key is that any authority that uses a surveillance tool needs to know that the person that got affected by a surveillance tool will eventually know, and they will be able. And this relates also to the right of a person to have a judicial recourse. You cannot resist a breach in your privacy rights if you don't know that your privacy rights might have been breached. So this is something that we will insist on companies that they need to go not above the law, not break the law, but that they can, respecting the law, do by themselves without being required by the law. But also we're trying to get in law a requirement or a more clear indication that they can do this and in which circumstances they can and can't disclose this to the user.
In the case of Colombia, legally it would be more or less what Luis Fernando just described. There is no legal obligation for them to do the notification, but it is not forbidden either. So our interpretation is that considering the due process, they should. But of course, that's our interpretation. There's not really cases we know about, but we know about practices. So when we've had the chance to talk informally with some people, we know that they disclose information to anybody that present a letter who looks like original with a seal. So authority, they will give them the data, at least especially true a few months ago. So that would be kind of the practice.
It's very similar, the case of Brazil, in terms of the uncertainty. There's no prohibition in the law, but it's also not required that they would notify the users. And that was, I think, by far the criteria that got a lot of resistance in the companies when we were trying to push for it, because they were arguing that in their interpretation, it's not even that it's uncertain. It's like there are risks that they would have to take to challenge and to get that into a practice. And that would antagonize with the judges, and there could be even sanctions that they alleged. And this is why last year, because we got so much resistance, we added this criteria as a bonus track to just highlight the fact that this was something that was maybe pushing the envelope very hard. So yeah, it was a bonus this year. It's not going to be a bonus track. It's going to be a normal criteria. But it was a way of trying to take their concerns into account.
In the case of Chile, it's just the same thing that my colleagues mentioned already, because there's no obligation, no prohibition either, but people do find out that their data has been given up by companies when they are eventually prosecuted, and only then. If they have not been formally prosecuted, like in a court where they have been communicated that there's an investigation against them, those processes may not ever come to a point where someone knows that their data has been requested, which is a problem in itself. For the purposes of the investigation and the analysis of this project, we went to see how that worked, but the truth is that, again, it's a criterion that does not find much use for the companies to provide the information, and so far it's not something that they have provided. In any case, what we have seen in practice also is that they are aware of about some of the things that are happening, at least in their legal department, but not enough to a point where they feel or they have felt the need to inform their users about that. They just comply with the requests that they receive in order to provide the information that they are requested, regardless of whether that impacts one or another of their users.
Can I just add one small thing? Because I think what was mentioned is really relevant, because many times authorities say No, there is notification, or the user knows when there is a criminal case, and it will be presented as evidence, and they will be able to challenge the validity of the evidence. But for example, just to give some points of data on this, in the case of Mexico, we have proven based on hundreds of access information requests that we made last year that more than 90% of the people that have been surveilled in the context of a criminal investigation are never charged with any crime. So this argument just doesn't fly. And also, there's a lot of requests that are not in a criminal investigation context, that are in national security, or in the case of Mexico, like we detected tens of authorities that requested, like the tax authority, electoral tribunal, several other authorities. So this is not a good argument to resist user notification. In fact, these statistics reveal that it's urgently needed.
Yeah, and this touches upon some things that happen in the context of criminal investigations that involve other forms of surveillance or forms of collection of information. And specifically, I'm thinking about the process of intervention of communications when they are focused on content, for instance, the intervention of telephone lines, where eventually the rules in Latin America allow or mandate for people to be informed that they have been subject to this kind of surveillance. The same thing just does not necessarily happen, or does not happen at all in most cases, with regards to information that has been collected about them or metadata itself. Even if it's more revealing about the practices of one person, it's less subject to transparency about its request by authorities. And that's one of the things that we want to push forward, because as we understand it, to collect that kind of information and to process that kind of information and to have that in part of an investigation is just as intrusive, if not worse, than the intervention of communications themselves.
Yeah, and I think that this highlights a couple of very good points. Is that highlighting on, if 90% are ones that don't end up in a criminal investigation, then there are all these people who are getting their lives intruded upon. And they don't know about it. They don't have a way of getting redress about it. And it also means that if you're going to be trying to challenge some of these laws and say that the government is going too far in accessing the data, it will only come up in the context of a criminal prosecution. And so you don't have, therefore, the most sympathetic clients, and you are presenting ones in which the government has decided they have enough evidence to prove somebody, and so it sort of biases the issues a little bit in that direction. The other thing about having the eventual accountability, even if it is not notice in time to challenge the request, if somebody gets notice afterwards, they find out about it, they can be activated by this to go and become an advocate, talk to a legislature about changing the rules. They can be inspired by this. So this could help with a political process. And I would say that it can also help for providing a reason for the government not to use dubious requests, knowing that there will be some accountability in the end. May mean that if your request is actually like a favor for a friend, if it's not based in law, then if there's going to be no accountability, maybe you'll do it anyway. But if you know eventually that there will be accountability, you might not want to use your police powers to investigate your child's new lover or something to find out if they're a good person. And this can actually reduce the number of requests, and thus can be helpful both for the users and for the companies, because they would have less requests to deal with.
And even, I would say, for authorities, because they will be more diligent on using these tools, since they cannot just use it willy-nilly. They need to apply themselves better. And I would just mention also that some argue that, well, then there's no problem. If there's no prosecution based on the data, then why do you care? It's important to stress that we have a right to privacy, not a right not to be indicted with evidence collected with through the intervention of private communications. It's not the only effect that is adverse to the person is to be prosecuted based on that data. There's other adverse effects, and as Juan Carlos mentioned, we can't stress that enough. That privacy is affected just by the collection of that data, the retention of that data, and that you, as an authority, you need to justify it. Why are you infringing on my rights? And sometimes it might be valid to get access to that data, and sometimes it won't. But it's important not to trivialize the discussion, just pointing at whether you are being prosecuted with that thanks to that data or not.
I think that there is an important value there for the corporations, as you said, that can have a certain, I mean, this issue of privacy is not just us asking for this, but it's certainly coming from a more general pressure, and having clear what they can and they cannot do is important. And here I would like to stress the issue that I think most of us are dealing with the big corporations, but at least in Colombia, the five corporations we're looking at are the ones who give the connectivity for a bit more than 80% of the population, and the rest, one is a Mexican ISP that does rural things, and there are more than 30 small ISPs that do pieces and bits of the other part of the connectivity in faraway places. And I think that they don't have the capacity, and we don't have the capacity to look over what they are doing, but there is more than 30 corporations. I wonder if we are able to clarify for the big ones these kind of things. It would be much easier to work with them to improve what they do, and therefore probably improve the way they respect human rights for a good amount of Colombians that are probably most of them the most vulnerable population. So I think that's something we should also be looking at. Certainty, not just for corporations, for us, but also for small corporations that are doing a great job by providing connectivity in very faraway places.
Yeah, I think it's just adding to what Carolina just said is that I think what I like about the project, one of the things that I like about the project is that it kind of raises the bar in terms of privacy protection for users. And hopefully, if these companies get better and improve their policies, and that would inspire or be a better standard for smaller companies that sometimes are not implementing those practices, but that could look for these standards that have been developed and then implement them into their daily practices. So I think it's also trying to impact these smaller companies, even though they're not part of the assessment, but I think it's one of the things that can encourage them to do.
And in that sense, it's a very good point to make the smaller companies rise up to some higher standards too, considering that in terms of cost, the fact that we have such large companies controlling most of the telecommunications market means that they do not, the level of impact that this may have in their bottom line in terms of the cost is not as high as has been suggested. And in that sense, like the raising the bar in although it may sound like a low level of importance, it's something that matters in terms of PR too, especially when there's this pressure not just from this report that appears nationally, but the fact that it appears internationally in several countries and that standards are being raised everywhere. So in that sense, to think that we can have those for the larger companies, but also for the smaller companies that try to provide the services, I think is a very good point also to think about this in terms of competition between them and those that in an ideal world we might opt to hire as the provider of our services.
Yeah, I think that brings up another good point, is the value of competition, that all these companies are competing for customers. They're competing on a wide variety of things, and price, quality of service. But something that customers do care about is whether they can feel confident that the company is going to be on their side when there is a dispute. And I think there are ways in which doing well, getting the PR benefits out of appearing in the report and doing well in the report can provide that incentive to take something which may have some difficulties or costs associated with it, but have it pay off in bringing some customers in. And the other thing I want to get some of your thoughts on, we talked a bit about how there were gray areas in the law where, it's not one way or the other. And I would say that perhaps that this is going to be a benefit to the companies to get some clarity about this by putting out a standard and trying to get as many of them as possible to stand on one side of that gray area. So can you talk a little bit about your methodology in picking those and also any communications you've had, engagement with the companies about trying to push them one way or the other on a gray area?
Well, I mean, when the telecommunications law in Mexico was being challenged, and there was this two-year period in which it being challenged, they had an assessment on what they understood the law was in private, but there was no public policy. There was no public statement on this is how we understand the law to mean. And we tell them, I mean, and they had, by the way, the wrong assessment. The court validated our assessment on who, when, and with a judicial warrant can do surveillance, and they were on the other side. In any case, we urged them to, well, okay, just make public that you are saying that you will give data without a warrant, because that's what you believe the law says. But they didn't want to say that in public as well. So definitely it was a challenge, but it's still even a challenge. Now that the law is clear, now the law is clear, just say what the law says and what the Supreme Court said that the law says. And still they are, I think, I don't know if it's cultural or I don't know what is. It's paradoxical that there's this culture of secrecy. The companies are very wary of the privacy of their policies and not so sometimes so wary of the privacy of their users, which is paradoxical.
Private privacy policy.
Yeah. So they are very jealous of their information that should be public to the user. About the privacy of their users, so it's kind of like paradoxical. But I think it's also, as you say, it's a process. I think in a way, companies are moving forward a little bit, and we expect the discussions to continue and to move forward. We've been seeing from 2016 to 2015 in the areas that can be comparable improvements, and now, and for example, in Mexico, AT&T. Has a substantial lead because it probably was more used to these kind of discussions by its operation in the US, and now it's putting some pressure on the other companies to kind of catch up. So we expect that next year we'll see more progress.
On gray areas?
I mean, on gray areas or engagement with the companies and getting progress.
I would say on engagement with the companies that it does. I mean, for us, it's we know the people on the companies. We do a lot of advocacy in Colombia, so we know them. But it hasn't been easy to talk about this at the beginning, especially. They tend to send us to the corporate responsibility people, the social social. Yeah, social responsibility people, and as I said previously, the point is transparency is associated to fighting corruption, and it took us a long time to really make them clear that it was really the policy people we were looking at, and that we were talking about another kind of transparency. But I do think that so far, probably the most effective process of the advocacy has been the issue that internationally, especially for multinationals, they are paying attention. They are doing transparency reports and they are starting to tell the people, local people, pay attention, you're doing that. That's been the most effective, and it also shows how little attention it has been paid previously, because in the case of Telefonica, that they did this transparent report last year, still they don't give data, but they kind of settle their policy, let's say. And if you compare the policy in that document to the local policy, it seems like two different companies. It's not the same. This one has raised the bar, and that's something one has to acknowledge, and that will mean that the local has to change.
Yeah, on gray areas, I think that one thing that we had to explain about the projects was that we are not assessing whether you're complying with the law, because we believe you're complying with the law. It's just about making public commitments. And that becomes harder when you're talking about gray areas, because then it's not even in the law. There's a dispute about what should be done. And then we had to be very specific about what kind of interpretations we believed they were the best ones, or the most the best for protecting privacy. And then it's like it's a process of debating and having that conversation with the companies. But we really saw a difference in the engagement last year and this year, because I think that when it was launched, it got a lot of media attention, and now it's been just more, just easier to have them talk and provide documents and comment on the methodology and things like that.
I think when we speak about gray areas of the law and how we push for some or other thing regarding that, those gray areas of the law become somewhat gray also in methodology, because this is where one point where the analytical tool becomes more of a political tool in order to help us for our advocacy purposes and to make the companies go and aim for higher standards of transparency towards their users or protection of the data of their users beyond the law. So in that sense, what can be seen if we go into the depth and into the details of each of the reports of each country where the project has taken place is that in many cases, although we know that we want higher standards, what we are looking for really is something to hold on to so that we can demand them from companies. From that point of view, and to the other side of the question, which is about the engagement based on the results that we have for these areas where the compliance that we seek is not of the law but of higher standards than those, is something that, again, because we have not published the report, we have not done so with the report as a tool, but it's something that we look forward to have also seen the experience that we have seen from the other people in Latin America especially, and also what has been reported to us by the people at the Electronic Frontier Foundation when they have spoken about what has worked and what has not worked. Obviously, different contexts give different results, but we are expecting to use also those lessons to promote these higher standards that we are looking for both nationally and internationally.
All right, well, we only have a few minutes left, so I was going to see if anybody in the audience had a question for the panel. Anyone want to jump in? All right, understood. It's late in the afternoon, the last day. So then let's just wrap it. Any final comments people have?
Well, I would just say that follow, if you want to know the report, you can visit it qdtd.mx or at our webpage, r3d.mx, and our Twitter at R3DMX or Facebook page, you can find both the Quien Define Tus Datos report and also another report that we launched last year, which is called The State of Surveillance Out of Control, which will be in English shortly, which you can find also statistics on how companies and authorities have used the surveillance tools in Mexico.
I have some Colombian reports here. Well, summaries, I'll leave them here.
Wonderful.
You can check the results from Brazil in quemdefendeseusdados.org.br. The name is in Portuguese, but everything is in English. There's an English version for the methodology and the criteria, and yeah.
The Chilean report you cannot find online yet, but you can find other interesting things at derechosdigitales.org if you're interested in policy for telecommunication companies, but also for governments and so on. Thank you.
All right, thank you all for coming. Well, thank you all.